Welcome to Keto on the Couch with Rachel and Joe.
I'm Rachel.
And I'm Joe.
And we are Two Crazy Ketos.
If you're new to our channel, welcome.
Yes, welcome to the more than 250 new subscribers since the last Keto on the Couch.
Now here on Two Crazy Ketos, we do different things like product reviews, we do recipe videos, we talk about various keto topics, and then every Monday, we sit down on the couch for Keto on the Couch. We just kind of talk about what's going on our lives for the week.
You can find us in different social media platforms like Facebook, Instagram, and Twitter.
And we have a website, which is twocrazyketos.com, and that's where you're going to find all of our different recipes. Now, we do upload at least 5 new videos every single week, so make sure you subscribe to our channel.
And don't forget to hit the little bell icon, and that way, every single time we upload a new video, you'll be alerted to it.
I almost started, like, saying all of your lines.
We've had a couple of videos that have been taped this week. Not all of them, like, aired yet.
No.
Where I'm not in them.
Yeah.
I'm out. I'm
and
done.
So I'm trying to, like, I had to say your lines over and over, and I filmed a couple of videos with Anthony, and Anthony doesn't know your line, so I had to say all your lines.
He just does, like, the deer in the headlight thing?
Yeah.
8,000 subscribers.
8,000 subscribers. 8,000.
Thank you, guys.
So a year ago, I looked. A year ago, at this time, we had 200 subscribers.
You guys are amazing. Thank you for just making this possible. Like, absolutely, you make Two Crazy Ketos happen.
Yes, and thank you for helping us to continue to grow by sharing the videos, by hitting the like buttons, by engaging it. You know, in fact, I was telling Rachel's mom, because she was asking, like, how does that all work? And I'm like, what happens is when you engage, when you leave comments or hit the like button, or when we're on the chat, or when you share it, it tells YouTube, hey, people are interested in these people. So now when somebody else goes on and just, like, looks up keto, or if they've looked at keto videos,
yeah,
we get recommended to them. So that only happens because you guys are liking and sharing and everything else.
Yeah.
So, and we're on our way to our goal, because my goal is 15,000 subscribers by the time we get to KetoCon.
That's crazy.
That's my goal, 15,000. So we've got to pretty much double between now and June.
Well, we definitely can't do that without them.
Yeah, we absolutely can't.
Oh my gosh, my armpits are getting sweaty. Just thinking of that.
I think mine are sweaty. So let's talk about the fact that you weren't in some videos. So yeah. Anthony did a couple of videos with us. One of them you've seen. We released it today. It's the Just Egg video. If you haven't seen it, I'm going to leave a link over Rachel's head.
Is that the most ironic title you've ever heard? Because it's not just egg.
That's what I was thinking about that this morning. I'm like, why would they name their product Just Egg, not from chickens?
Did you take a whiff of that stuff before you made it?
Well, of course, we shot the video. We almost didn't shoot the video after smelling it.
It was like old grass clippings.
I have to say this.
Why did you leave the bottle in the refrigerator?
Because Anthony said he's going to make some for his girlfriend and make her try it.
I hope that's not their Valentine's Day dinner.
It's kind of mean, actually. But,
man.
But no meaner than we wanted to make sure we saved some for you to get to eat it. So
yeah, I'm not eating that.
So let's talk about Anthony, because yeah, we smelled that stuff. It was pretty bad.
Rank.
But we had a good time. So we filmed a different video, and then Anthony found that Just Eggs, and then we filmed, and then he was like, oh, I want to film another one. So we did that. But I wanted to mention, like, why Anthony's doing that video, because first of all, when it comes to the treats, you've said that you don't want to do as many treats.
Yeah, I really don't. It's something I struggle with, and I'm working really hard to get rid of my sweet tooth as much as possible. So, you know, occasionally when we do a product review, I can handle it, but too many sweets just send me, like, down a snowball.
Yeah.
Snowball effect.
So if we have a whole bunch at once that we want to do, whether it's a company that sent us something or it's just something we found, if we have a bunch of them, I may do a couple of them with the boys, and Rachel won't be in there. She's still going to do reviews, but she's just worried that, like, hey, if I have, like, 5 cookies in a week, that's going to trigger me to start wanting to eat cookies.
It's just something that you're able to put those things in their proper place better than I do. I mean, you have different struggles than I do.
Yeah, I have.
But
I
that
have
is just
a whole
one
mess of struggles.
That was just one, and I just want to stay on track, and I just know that I'm not going to if I taste a bunch of cookies.
Bunch of sweets at once. Oh, so that's what I was going to say. I completely forgot what I was going to say. So with the just eggs thing, so I noticed a bunch of the comments. We did not make that video with saying, hey, you guys need to eat this.
No.
Or you guys need to try this.
It was more a case of like, look at this ridiculousness that, you know, you're saying it's just egg. Instead of us eating an egg, let's have 45 other ingredients put together to try to chemically make an egg.
Yeah.
Seems like this is a lot of work for nothing.
I like, what does Nurse Cindy call it? Frankenfood?
Frankenfood.
Frankenfood.
Because it's just all pretend. You know, I remember there was a push, you know, when the kids were a little bit younger, and even when I was younger, that everything was tofu, all the same, you know, ingredient tofu made into different shapes.
Right. Right. The boys ate that a lot because they would go visit my mom, and my mom's always cared about her health.
Yeah.
And so she was trying to not eat a lot of meat. And again, we didn't know. Nobody knew, or at least we didn't know as a family, about the canola oil and stuff like that. So, but she didn't want to deprive the boys.
But it was tofu, hot dogs.
So it was like, yeah, not dogs and
tofu,
things like
turkey,
that.
Turkey, tofu-ti, like all kinds of stuff. But now we're not even dealing with a single ingredient, you know, shaped into something and then colored to look like that food. Now we're just dealing with a bunch of chemicals just thrown together to achieve something, and it's not good.
I liked it when Anthony picked up the eggs, and again, he just did that on his own. He didn't even tell me he was gonna do that, and I figured we have to talk about this a little bit because you weren't part of the video, but he just took the egg and he was like, we read the ingredients on the just egg, and he was like, give me that over there. Cracks it, and he's like, that's an egg. It's one ingredient.
What I loved that kind of came out of that is he's in a younger generation,
mm-hmm.
and sometimes, you know, you're watching, like, television and entertainment, and there seems like there's such a push for this Frankenfood that you're like, am I totally just out of touch? No. Everybody's not doing it. Remember they used to say that with, like, you know, drugs or, like, don't give in to peer pressure because, like, you know, people say everybody's doing it. And it looks like that. You see celebrities doing it. You see a lot of different influencers, you know, that are eating this way. And you're like, is this what I'm supposed to do? Am I out of touch? And it's like, everybody's not doing it. I
right.
mean, Anthony's 19 years old. He's in this generation and he's not interested in doing it.
And it's something that I really took away from it because, again, we've said before, I mean, he doesn't do keto, but he does try to eat cleaner whole food and he loves keto food. He just also likes his sugar and stuff. But he doesn't want all the processed food. So in the Just Eggs video, he's like, I'm going to have to make this better. And so he grabbed ketchup. And he's been eating that ketchup that we get at Sprouts. I can't remember the name of it.
Yeah.
But he said to me last night, he's like, I don't want that sugared stuff anymore. He was like, I've gotten such a taste of what a real ketchup should taste like. I don't want that other stuff anymore. So it kind of makes you feel proud, like, hey, we still have an influence. Like,
yeah, and I want that to be an encouragement to everybody. So even if, hey, I only see my nieces and nephews sometimes when they come over, maybe you only have your grandkids for spring break or summer, but those little interactions that you have and the food that you're presenting them, it makes an impact. It makes a lasting impression. Like, you're making forward momentum in their lives, and, you know, be encouraged by that. I also wanted to give a little shout out before we get into, you know, comments and things. I wanted to say I'm so proud of my little brother.
Okay.
Let me show you a really old school photo of me and my little brother. How cute is he?
He's going to kill you for sharing this
photo. He's going to totally kill me for sharing it. But I did want to say he has been on keto for less than 2 months, 24 pounds down.
He was the last holdout in the family.
24 pounds. I am super incredibly
awesome.
Proud
That's
of
awesome.
My little brother. But what was funny was he said, yeah, you don't get to decide where the weight comes off. He's like, my hat is loose, right? And you're like, my hat is loose. Okay, I can think of a million places where I would like to have some, like, looseness. My hat, really? But I guess it's coming off from the top down.
Well, that's a good thing. It's coming off. That's what matters. So with Anthony, I did want to say, let me know or let us know down in the comments if you guys like seeing the boys in the videos where they're going to maybe step up and do some more reviews, either with just me and them or joining the two of us.
What are they going to say? Like, no, get your kid out of here.
I like the idea that we're seeing it from another perspective, a different generation, what they think about it from people who don't only eat keto foods. Like, and again, we said it in one of the videos, the one that I haven't released yet, but we had said that, you know, here's a kid who, if he likes a keto product, especially a dessert,
then we know it's good.
Then you know it's good because he's not going to want to eat it if it's not good.
That it's not just that we're so desperate for something like that's a baked good that we will just take anything, you know.
Another video that I did yesterday that's coming out Tuesday, so if you're seeing this on Monday, it's coming out tomorrow, is I filmed, that was the other one without you, was how to make a keto chow type meal replacement shake with no whey protein and no sucralose.
Wow.
Because I know a lot of people say, hey, like I really like the idea of keto chow, but I don't want whey protein or I don't want sucralose. Well, there is a way you can make that. And so that video is going to come out on Tuesday. And because again, what makes keto chow really good is not the protein powder.
Even though chocolate toffee is awesome, there are other flavored protein powders out there.
Yeah. What makes it so unique and such a good product that we like is that each shake gives you 1/3 of all the vitamins, electrolytes, and nutrients you need. Yeah. So I'm going to show you in that video that's coming out on this Tuesday how you can make it with no whey protein and no sucralose. So you can use any kind of protein. You can use a pea protein, you can use egg protein, you can use bone broth protein powder, you know, whatever you want to use. So watch for that video coming out. Also, I wanted to mention that this week's Keto Chow Flavor of the Week is eggnog, and it's 20% off. So you can use the link down below in the description to get that. And they're featuring one of our recipes. You got to eat this week.
And what a meal.
So if you're new to our channel, the entire month of January, we did Keto Chow and Keto Bricks. Rachel actually did only Keto Chow. I did Keto Chow and Keto Bricks, with the exception of 5 days when we went away to Omaha.
So I sort of made them up in February.
So Rachel made them up in February. So she, when I started eating on February 1st, Rachel didn't start eating until this past Thursday. And we broke her fast with
a giant prime rib.
A giant prime rib. We did OMAD. I got...
How are you going to eat anything else other than that?
I went to Whole Foods and we got a prime rib. We didn't get choice. I got prime rib because I figured, you know what? We were going to go out to eat. This was our logic behind us. We were going to go out to eat to like Texas Roadhouse. Texas Roadhouse has a 16-ounce prime rib. It's like $26.
Yeah.
So by the time you pay the tip and you get a drink or something like that, you're, and tax and restaurant tax and all that, we were be looking at close to $70 for the two of us to go out to each get that prime rib. So I went to Whole Foods and we got a 4.5-pound prime rib because it was on sale. So it was $70. It was like $77 and then 10% off because you're a prime member.
Right.
So we paid $70 and we're like, we can eat as much as we want. Kind of thought we would have some leftover for the kids.
I did not think that.
So we smoked it in the smoker to 120 degrees. Now, if you haven't seen that video, we have that vlog over, I'll put it over Rachel's head. But we smoked it to 120 degrees and then we put it in the sous vide for 24 hours. Now, it didn't need to be in the sous vide for that long, but we wanted to make sure that like all of that fat, everything started breaking down and turning into candy.
It was meat candy.
And so we put it at 132 degrees for 24 hours. And wow, that thing was amazing.
Now, the other thing that was cool was I, of course, finished mine, Giant's Dinosaur Fred Flintstone steak.
Yeah, it was almost 2 pounds.
Joe did not, so we had leftovers, but like brisket sometimes even, prime rib is hard to reheat.
Yeah, you can't because, well, the whole idea of prime rib is you cook the entire thing and you really... When you get a prime rib, you don't want the two ends that were exposed, right? You want the middle. You don't want the ends. So you really can't reheat it. It's not gonna have the same texture. It's losing some of the juices because that's the whole idea behind a prime rib.
But.
So what we did was I had like 11 ounces left. I could not finish that thing. So.
Wimp.
So we ate it the next day. But what I did was when I realized I couldn't finish it, I was like, well, how can we preserve this? And I tried this and it really worked. So I re-vacuum sealed my cooked prime rib. And then put it in the refrigerator.
Uh-huh.
And then the next day, I put it in the sous vide for about an hour, hour and a half. At the same temperature, 132 degrees.
And we were back. It was moist. It was juicy. It was delicious. So definitely, if you have something where it doesn't, you don't feel like it tastes good, it gets dried out, it's any kind of steak, and you don't finish it, try the sous vide.
Now, somebody on that video actually left a comment. I don't remember who it was, but they left a comment about they were trying to eat more carnivore and were going to invest in a sous vide. And what can they? How do they not screw up their meat? Here's the key about a sous vide. It's almost impossible to screw up your food with a sous vide.
Which makes me really happy because I am so good at screwing stuff up.
So if you don't know, the way a sous vide works is if you're cooking in a water bath. Now, sometimes it's not going to look super appetizing like a steak.
It's like gray looking when it's done.
So what's going to happen is, and that was the only thing with the prime rib. So we put the prime rib in. I cooked it for an hour. So remember, when you put it in there, you had this big pink section on the flat top. So when I had the sous vide to reheat it, the very outer part that was pink, just the outer part, was now like a gray. But again, I wouldn't even say the thickness of a piece of paper, would you say?
No, no.
But as soon as you cut it, everything else was back to that pink. And it's just because of it being in that water bath. But anyway, the way the sous vides work is you're going to vacuum seal or put in a silicone bag. We just use vacuum seal because silicone bags are ridiculously expensive. You put your meat in there. You put the sous vide on what temperature you want your meat to be. So, for example, steak. If you want a medium rare steak.
I only want a medium rare steak.
You're going to put it at between 128 and 130 degrees. You're going to put that steak in there. And you're gonna let it go for at least an hour, depends on how thick the steak is, but you can let that thing go for 2 hours, 4 hours, 10 hours, 24 hours.
It doesn't change.
It is never going to overcook that steak.
Is that crazy?
Because it's gonna bring the water up to that temperature, and then anything, the longer whatever you have is sitting in there, it's gonna bring that up to that. So if you have it sitting there long enough, a steak, if you have a steak this thick, like we did, right? The steak was this thick.
Yeah.
24 hours, it brought it to 132 degrees from one edge to the other. And that's why when you cut it open, you don't have those layers. If you think about when you get a steak and you cook it on a grill or you cook it in a pan or you cook it in the oven, you have layers, right? You have the outer layer that's cooked and then the inner layer that's cooked a little bit less, and then the middle is the rare. So you get like a medium rare. It's not pink all the way through.
Right, because the thickness changes with the shape of the meat.
Right, whereas with a sous vide, you're gonna put that steak in there and it's gonna be 128 degrees edge to edge. Now the very outside is gonna be this grayish brown, but it's not appetizing look. So what you do is now when you take that sous vide out, you stick it onto a cast iron pan, you stick it onto your grill, 30 seconds each time. All you wanna do is get a sear. It's kind of like reverse searing.
Yeah.
Now you're gonna get the look, you get that char, you get that seasoning, but you've got a medium rare or a medium, whatever you want, from one edge to the other. And the sous vide, because it's taking time, it breaks down all the muscles and the fibers.
So tender.
So it makes it super tender.
And it's one of those things where you eat it and it's not a steak where you had four bites of that steak was perfect.
Right.
And the rest of it was okay. Every bite is perfect.
So it is a great investment. If for nothing else, if you're a steak eater, it's great for that. But if you're a chicken eater, what's one of the worst things about cooking chicken breast is getting it to not be dry, right?
Right.
You overcook chicken breast and you've ruined it. So you can put that chicken breast in there, set it for like 150 degrees, and let it go for 5-6 hours if you want. You only need really an hour unless it's frozen, but let it go for 5 or 6 hours. It's gonna be super tender, super juicy, and then you can take it out and again, do the same thing. Do a quick sear in a pan to get that crunch on the outside, but it's gonna be tender, juicy on the inside.
I just think about all of the times that I am in the middle of cooking lunch or dinner and get called away for something.
And now it's too late.
And now I come back and it's like, dang it, now I've ruined it.
And you can do the same thing with your vegetables. I mean, just anything you can think of. But that's what makes it so good is that you're never gonna overcook it. And if you're like us and you have a lot of frozen food, like we get a lot of frozen steaks, you take that frozen steak, stick it in the sous vide, add an hour onto your cooking time, and it's still gonna cook it all. So it's kind of like having an Instant Pot. It's just gonna cook it all.
Amazing.
So you wanna do some comments?
Yes.
Oh, wait, what else did we eat this week?
Well, we had Buffalo Wild Wings.
We had Buffalo Wild Wings.
And then last night you went back to the Blackstone and made hamburger bacon.
Oh my gosh.
And that was 3-week cured bacon.
Yeah, so before, like halfway through, when we got home from Omaha, we started a bacon, which if you're not making your own bacon, I don't know what to tell you. You can make your own bacon. There's a video up here. And if you don't have a smoker, you can still do it. Actually, one of our subscribers, Nev, doesn't have a smoker.
Yeah.
And she's just curing it and then slicing it up and sticking it in the freezer or whatever. And then just kind of going on without smoking it. She's just not smoking it. But so you don't have to smoke it. But you could also dry smoke, you know, cold smoke it with just a little thing in a cooler.
Right.
But yeah, so we made it, it aged for 3 weeks, and then when I actually broke my fast, I smoked it up. So for dinner last night, we got the cowboy burgers from Whole Foods because they were on sale for, it was like $4 a pound, which you can't beat that.
They're very flavorful. I used to have my, you know, hamburger drenched in sauces. There's so much flavor going on in there. I didn't put a single thing on my burger.
Yeah, so we had, I cooked that on the Blackstone. What I like about the Blackstone is no cleanup, right? No pans to clean, everything's cooking outside.
I like that all of the smells are outside.
So I cooked like 2 pounds of bacon, and then this way it's pre-cooked, and I cook it like 90% through, so that when the kids go to heat it up in the microwave, it doesn't burn it. You finish
Boom
it off.
Done.
But, so we each had a 1/2 pound burger. Then we had like, I think you had like 3 thick slices of bacon. And when I say thick, I mean, they were like this thick. Each slice was ridiculously thick. Then you had, what did I give you? 4 eggs?
Yeah.
4 eggs. I had 7 eggs. All on the Blackstone. And that was like, that was our meal. That was our meal for the day. I had finished up my wings from Buffalo Wild Wings earlier in the day.
The only thing that I want differently is I like my eggs cooked just a touch longer. I don't like runny eggs. Do you guys like runny eggs? Joe is a runny egg guy.
Not super runny, but I do want the yolks.
He likes to dip things.
I do want the yolks. Well, first of all the nutrients, the more you cook the yolks, the more you lose the nutrients. So you want to try.
I'll take the hit.
You want to try to not overcook the yolks. But usually I have a little dome thing for the Blackstone, but I was cooking dinner at 8 o'clock at night. And so like, I couldn't tell if it was done enough. And I knew that you hadn't eaten. It was 8 o'clock at night. You hadn't eaten
yet.
It's
like, I got to get this down her gullet. But I would be interested to find out 2 things. One, how do you like your eggs?
Yeah, let us know down in the comments section.
And number 2, how do you like your meat? Are you medium rare? Are you a rare? Are you well done? My dad was well done.
I used to be a well done steak eater. Now I want it medium.
Felt like you might as well
be
eating
medium rare on a steak.
Charcoal briquettes.
Yeah. I want medium rare steaks. I want medium rare burgers. And I used to be a well done. So it's kind of funny how your tastes do change on this. Speaking of eating all this meat, I'm like binge watching Strong Sisters. I'm in anticipation of getting a cow. We're going to get a cow. And I'm binge watching them. They're actually coming out with a cookbook on cooking the awful.
Oh, that's going to be awful.
But no, they're like, they actually put up this video about like, if you don't like awful, which if you don't know what awful is like all the parts that nobody wants to eat.
Because they're awful.
Like the kidney and the heart. And they're showing some different things. And this was a good idea. So They're talking about like liver, like you people, we spend all of this money on multivitamins and it's pretty much expensive urine. And most of the vitamins that you're trying to get in a multivitamin, they're in the liver. So if you can just eat liver. So what she said, if you don't like the taste of liver, you freeze the liver and then you cut it into like pill size forms, like a pill size.
Yeah.
And then just divide it up. You only need like an ounce a day. An ounce. It's like maybe that much. But you divide it into like, you just take this liver, it's frozen, and you cut it up and then you just pop them like a pill.
Oh.
And then you're getting all of the vitamins, all the nutrients for like pennies.
Just make sure that it's tiny, tiny. You don't want to choke.
You got
to
see that video. I'll have you watch the video.
Okay.
But it was really interesting because they were talking about like chicken feet. Like, I think you would like chicken feet. If you cook them, if you cook them in a broth and stuff, because you like to like chew out the bone marrow and stuff. Like they're eating the toenails and everything from the chicken.
Oh my Lord. I have to have the food not look like
food.
Well, like, you know, the animal. Like, I'm sure that frog legs are probably delicious, but there's no way that I could see them and not be thinking, like, ribbit, like, the entire time I'm eating them.
That's true. Well, what about chicken wings?
I just, they don't look, I don't know. Do you think, especially a drum?
I think it looks like a leg.
I don't think so.
I see that chicken leg, and I think of your legs.
You think my legs look like a chicken leg?
No, it's just like that nice shape of the thigh coming down.
Man, I better watch myself. Maybe put some hot sauce on me and I'm done for.
You want to do some comments, some subscriber of the week?
Yes, please.
Okay, so we're going to start off with an encouragement. This is an update. It's not a full story, but it's from Miss September.
September!
Who's been a subscriber for a long time. And she's got a non-scale victory.
Awesome.
So she put, these are a size 7-8. They are a little tight. But does my mommy flab hang over a little bit if I don't suck it in? Yes. But with the right shirt and the posture, I'm totally rocking these.
I love it.
When I was a size 20, I wouldn't have even considered shorts. And take a look at her.
Oh my gosh, September, you look awesome.
So again, she went from a size 20 to a size 7-8. We're going to celebrate that.
Oh my gosh, that is so stinking exciting.
Okay, so.
How cute are her socks, too?
So let's do some subscriber of the weeks. The first one is going to be Rachel.
Hey, Rachel.
And real quick, she wrote, these pictures were taken a year apart. The one on the right is after 6 months of keto. I've got a long way to go, but thanks to this group, I know I can do it.
Oh, Rachel. Absolutely gorgeous. Oh my goodness.
What a difference.
Wow, it's just so beautiful.
What a difference. You can see a difference all over and look at her face.
She's a baby woman.
Yeah.
You are young, girl.
Next one is going to be Leanne.
Hey, Leanne.
And Leanne said, it has been a year since starting my keto diet. Let's call it a journey or a lifestyle.
Yeah.
She said, I'm down 65 pounds.
Wow.
And I went from a 14-16 to a 6-8.
Wow, that is awesome.
She said, my background, my husband and I both work in a high school. God bless you.
Yeah, seriously, thank
and
you.
And lived through a school shooting in January of 2018.
Oh my gracious.
I gained over 40 pounds that year due to stress and anxiety.
Yeah.
After looking at Christmas pictures in December of 2018, I realized what I've done to myself. February 9th, 2019, I changed my life and I never looked back. The weight loss is great, but my skin is also better. The bloat is gone and I went from 3 to 4 migraines a month to 2 in the last year.
Wow.
Keto has changed my life. Take a look at these pictures.
Oh my gracious.
Wow.
Absolutely beautiful.
Wow.
Wow, you look good.
You look amazing.
And thank you for sharing, you know, those specific things. My skin is better. The migraine headaches are gone. Because that really will speak to somebody.
Yeah. So the last one's going to be Carmen.
Hey, Carmen.
And Carmen wrote, alrighty, into the pool I jump.
Oh, let's do this.
She said, hi, I'm planning on being 50 this year and many more years after that.
Well, it's like you. You plan on being 50.
I'm going to be 50. There's no planning about it.
Even if you don't plan for it, it's happening, sir.
She said, I can't fault myself on that since I feel physically so much younger than at one point, meh, not so much.
Yeah.
I suffer from an autoimmune disorder called HS, which I didn't know even existed until 2 years ago when an NP I saw instead of my regular GP informed me that I wasn't nasty. I actually had a real legitimate issue and it wasn't my fault.
Wow.
Funny how that changed what I thought about myself. Anyhow, on to research, and after evaluating what my options were, diet change was pretty much my only choice since I can't stand the idea of taking medication or having procedures that may not work.
Yeah.
I've been a sturdy girl for as long as I can remember, so inflammation from my autoimmune issues and being an emotional eater really had me all over the place since my 20s. 2018, I topped the scale at 230 pounds. At 5'2", not a good thing, but after my diagnosis, I finally found it in me to try to help myself, and after months of eliminating foods and sugar, I finally landed on keto.
Good.
My lucky day. I figure since my body and my skin are much improved, and thanks to the keto community and all the things I've learned in the last 10 months, I've been amazed with myself. Yes, I'm tooting my own horn.
You should, girl.
She said, I took my best friend to show me how much of a difference a few months made since I thought about giving up at the end of August. She demanded I take pictures in the shirt I wore on my birthday the year before, and I cried. I weighed in at 172 pounds this morning, and that's using my fingers and my toes, 58 pounds with a goal of landing somewhere around 145 to 150 by my birthday. This last picture is from December, trying to figure out what to wear for a holiday dinner. Yes, I'm standing in my bathtub. I'm a short girl. Problems when you do when you don't have a mirror low enough to see what how much lower than a chest up. So here are her before pictures. And take a look at the picture she's talking about in the bathtub.
Oh my gosh. Well, you look super hot, number one. But the picture of her in the same shirt is amazing.
It is amazing.
Absolutely amazing. You look incredible, Carmen. Here's me tooting the horn for you. Like,
you
yes,
look awesome.
You need to toot that horn, girl.
Okay, so let's do some comments. So Jesus Freak wrote.
Hey, Jesus Freak.
Jesus Freak is a longtime subscriber.
Yes,
like
so
since
glad
we had like
100
subscribers.
Yes.
She said, hi, Rachel. I knit on a loom too, and I love it. I find it very relaxing. I find it easier than needle knitting.
I absolutely love it. I finished your hat last night, and I already have like tied my yarn on for the next one.
Rachel wrote,
hey, Rachel.
I sew clothes for my granddaughter, and I pray while working on it, covering her in prayer.
Oh, my gosh. Okay, I'm going to cry, but that, what a beautiful thing. I love that. Yeah, it's like we can pray for people even when they're not there in the room. I, you know, will take my walks or ride my bike or something, and I'll go around the college where Caleb is going to school.
So Renee wrote,
hey, Renee.
Hey, guys. Joe, I sent the info to Rachel about the sleeping positions and pillow use. I'm not sure if that's what you were speaking of, but I'm so glad you're doing better.
That's the one. Thank
you. Yeah, I'm doing much better. Thank you for those suggestions. She said, Rachel, I love your she shed. Personally, I totally agree on the cozy feel of wood walls and a fireplace. And if it's too hot for a fire, put candles in there for a warm glow. It's definitely prettier than the wood paneling that we had in our house in the 70s. Oh, and the smoky mirror wall in my parents' bedroom.
Yep.
I love having lots of throw pillows and fleece throws to cuddle in and spice-scented candles.
I love candles. Don't they just, it just adds like that extra layer of cozy. Caleb got one that was like cafe au lait. Oh my gosh, I love that one so much.
I like candles till you put them out or when they get to the end. I don't like the smell of when they get to the very bottom.
Burnt wick smell.
But it's funny you mentioned the wood panel wall. So yeah, I grew up with that thin paneling, that wood paneling.
Me too.
And it looked horrible. So when we were trying to pick walls out or the flooring, Rachel would find one. I'm like, nope, too much look of that wood paneling. Like, it's got to be unique. It's got to look like it's actual planks of wood. I didn't want anything that reminded me of all of those 4x8 sheets of paneling.
Oh, yeah.
A pal wrote,
hey, pal.
Joe, Keep some DMSO handy for your back tweaks. It'll give you a garlic taste in your mouth when you rub it on your skin, but it really does help to heal. Use other pain stuff, but DMSO to heal. As far as comfy house thing, my friends tell me that the inside of a home looks like a unicorn threw up because I have a lot of different colored rooms. The colors are soothing to me, including my chili pepper red kitchen. I do like your idea of wood flooring on the wall. You've inspired me to possibly take that project on this summer.
How neat. I love that unicorn. I love different colors.
Yeah.
And they all make me feel very creative. I love that. I'm having a hard time getting past his comment that if you rub this lotion on, it's going to make your mouth taste like garlic.
It's a pretty powerful lotion, but it also stains everything. So you got to actually, when you put the DMSO on, you got to make sure, like, you're putting on old clothes. Don't, like, lay in your bed because it stains everything permanently.
Fascinating, though, that it could have that effect, right? That's, like, super cool.
Yeah. Slapstick wrote,
hey, Slapstick.
Traveling days are my favorite days to eat, but I don't fly. I drive. If I have a 14-hour drive, I scope out the restaurants on the path and I eat something delicious. I'd prefer fasting when it's a normal day with work and such.
That is so interesting. Yeah. I love that. Just finding what is good for you, because for me, I am the worst at eating while traveling.
Right.
Yeah. It's like I'm always anticipating I'm going to find some great snack that, you know, and the time to eat it. And usually I'm just not that hungry on a travel day. So it's like just total opposites.
Right.
So cool.
Kavita wrote,
hey, Kavita.
I've been getting the dizziness too when I lie down and I get up. I've started upping my saltwood Redmonds, but I still think I need more. It's hard when it's been drilled into you that salt is no good. I know it's a lie though.
It is hard to get out of that mentality.
It is really hard to get out of the mentality. It's hard to get out of the salt mentality, the cholesterol mentality. You know, you just keep seeing people over and over like, oh, high cholesterol. Unless your cholesterol is over 300, don't worry about it. Worry about your triglycerides. Worry about what your remnant cholesterol is. And again, like Dr. Siwa said, if you can, get your doctor to do how much LDL-A to LDL-B do you have? That's right. What you really want to know. Patty Epps wrote,
hey, Patty.
Can you please explain the glucose insulin response again? I heard it was an increase in glucose, not a decrease. Thanks. I'm trying to learn this glucose thing. Okay, so let's preface this with saying we're not doctors or nurses or, you know, any kind of medical professional at all. So I can tell you what I've studied, what I've learned, that kind of stuff. So when you have glucose and insulin, you bring glucose into your body, your mm-hmm. body's going to release insulin to deal with that glucose. So if you eat a bunch of sugar, you spike your insulin. Now, anytime you eat, whether it be sugar or fat or protein, your body is going to have an insulin response. The amount of insulin response is going to be dictated by how much glucose, how much sugar is in there. So if you eat a spoon of sugar, you're going to release a ton of insulin. If you eat some fat, then you're going to release a little bit of insulin. So what we were talking about was that some people have something called a cephalic insulin response. And a lot of times it's people who are diabetics, that kind of stuff. But it can happen in anybody. Mm-hmm. And basically what it is when you put something in your mouth that's sweet, even if it's not sugar, it could be, stevia. It could be you're just putting it in your mouth and swishing around. You don't even have to swallow it. Just tasting it. Your body goes, oh, I'm about to get sugar. Let me release some insulin. So one of the things we were talking about was if you have that, there's no way to measure your insulin at home. You can only measure your glucose. So I measure my glucose to see how much does a product impact me. I don't want to see more than a 10 or 15 point jump when I eat something. Although now I'm learning with the continuous glucose monitor that a lot of things spike my glucose.
It like really does.
Bending down to tie my shoes. Or running around the corner.
Or thinking about getting up in the morning.
That all spikes your glucose, but it's not me eating something. It's my body creating glucose. It's like, hey, he needs some sugar to get going.
Revving to get up.
But I don't want to consume sugar, so I measure different foods to see how much of a spike do I have. I don't mind so much if it's only a 3, 4, 5, 10 point spike. What you don't want to see is your blood sugar go from 100 to 130 after you eat, or 80 to 120 after you eat. 80 to 90, in my personal opinion, you're fine.
Eat a spoonful of sugar while trying to get up in the morning.
Nice. Well, your body wouldn't create glucose because you're giving it glucose.
Okay.
So anyway, that's what that whole thing works. Again, you can't really measure your insulin at home, but my theory, and again, it's only a theory, is if you have a cephalic insulin response, if you eat something sweet, you should see a major drop in blood sugar because your body's going to release insulin. And since you're not actually taking in glucose, it's going to lower your glucose.
Right.
Now, I'm not saying 4 or 5 points. I'm saying you'd have to see a major drop, like, because it thinks it's getting sugar. So I'm thinking like 10, 15, 20 points. And again, it's only a theory, but I know other people have said they kind of theorize the same thing. But if insulin actually lowers your glucose and you're not giving yourself glucose, it should lower it beyond where you're at instead of just keeping you level.
Makes sense.
Constance wrote,
"Hey, Constance.
Did Rachel just say balls to the wall?"
That's how we do it. Balls to the wall.
Lucy wrote,
"Hey, Lucy.
Yes, I used to love Homeland. I didn't realize it was still on. I haven't watched since season 3 or 4. Wow, thanks."
Where are you at?
I just started season 5. I watched episode 1 of season... Actually, I'm like halfway through episode 1 of season 5.
5?
Yeah. And a lot of people had said that the first 2 seasons were awesome and then it dropped off, which is absolutely true. Like, season 3 definitely was a drop-off and a struggle to get through.
Mm-hmm.
Season 4 picked it back up. And so I'm hoping season 5 is good. But the second half of season 4 was really, really good. I really enjoyed that one. Carol wrote,
"Hey, Kara.
You should watch Dead to Me with Christina Applegate, and another one is Good Omen on Amazon."
Ooh,
they're excellent.
We gotta check those out.
I'll have to look at those. Lisa wrote,
"Hey, Lisa.
I love Homeland. The Americans is great too."
Well, you used to watch The Americans.
I used to watch The Americans, and I kind of like fell off after season 2. But that's what happens. If I watch a show, when I was watching The Americans when it was on week to week to week.
That's where you lost.
And that's where you kind of lose it because you miss a couple of episodes and then you forget about it later on.
You need to binge it.
I need to binge watch a whole bunch of seasons. And then you get to the point where like, is this still on? Oh, now I got to wait. Mel wrote,
"Hey, Mel.
I've been watching Homeland since season 1, episode 1. I love, love, love the show."
Well, I like seeing somebody say that it's good all the way through.
Yeah. Joe's friend wrote,
"Hey, Joe's friend.
I love that little fireplace in your she shed and the fact that it has windows on 2 sides. It's what makes it cozy. And to me, sun-filled rooms make me happy."
Yeah.
"I almost always do nothing before noon, but I do have 2 cups of black coffee each day. I've never fasted other than IF-16-8, and I'm going to join your challenge, though it's intimidating. I'm going to shoot for 36 hours, and we will see what happens. The encouragement of a group should be very helpful."
I think it's going to be fun.
Yvette wrote,
"Hey, Yvette.
I think I'm going to try the fast with you, but if I wait until noon, do I need to eat all of my macros before I go to bed, or just eat until I'm full? And if I'm short on protein and fat and calories, is it okay? I've never really fasted before, so I'm a little scared. I'm finding I'm cheating and eating more than I should, so I need to reel this in." Okay, so yeah, so the whole idea is if you're doing an OMAD, if you're doing like 2 meals a day, you're going to, like Dr. Barry says, eat until you're comfortably full. Now, it doesn't mean eat until, like, hey, if I take a step, it's going to come up through my esophagus.
Right.
You want to eat till you're comfortably full.
That's Rachel full.
That is your body saying, you've had enough. So if you don't get all of your calories in, if you don't get all of your fat macros in, then don't worry about it. Now, if you start finding that, like, hey, I am consistently eating 1,000 calories less than I'm supposed to, then I would say you probably need to do more than 1 meal. Like, that's something that I have to do. I can't do OMAD. I cannot consume 2,000 calories in a sitting. It doesn't work for me. I get sick to my stomach. It starts coming up my esophagus. I thought you were doing the tears over there for me.
No.
So I have to spread my eating window out to like 2 to 3 to 4 hours. So I'll eat and then I'll eat again in a little while. I'm not going to overeat that way because I'm limiting it, but I just can't do it in one sitting. And you have to kind of go by what your body does. But your body, so long as you're eating regular food, and I mean, I'm not talking about cakes, even stuff that you make at home. I'm talking about eating your vegetables, eating, you know, carnivore foods, things like that. Just nutrients, fat, and protein. If you're eating that, your body is not going to let you overeat.
My body tells me I'm full and I'm like, pipe down, body.
Tiffany wrote,
"Hey Tiffany,
I wish I could insert a happy dance here. I'm so on board with this. I am so addicted to coffee.
Ugh.
I normally don't eat any food before noon, but sometimes I have 2 to 3 bulletproof coffees. I'm thinking about doing the keto chow as my first meal at noonish, so count me in. I'm so grateful for the two of you. By the way, I do Facebook to be able to follow you all, and I'm on there as Edith Sylvia.
Aww.
I also follow you on Instagram. I'm so glad you're doing better, Joe. Thank you so much for loving us all."
Tiffany, you made our day. Thank you. Oh my goodness, that's so sweet. But like, yeah, the bulletproof coffee, that was my Achilles heel.
Yeah, let's talk about the bulletproof coffee. I hate to say this to you or break to you or anybody else, but I know it was a hard lesson for us as well. If you're drinking a bulletproof coffee in the morning, you're having a meal.
Dang it.
I mean, it's...
That's not fair.
If you think about it, what did you have for breakfast pre-keto? What did you have for breakfast on the standard American diet? I know for myself, it was usually a little bit lighter. I would have a couple of eggs or maybe grab an egg McMuffin at McDonald's, or you would have some oatmeal with a little bit of yogurt. It was usually a lower calorie, a filling lower calorie, right? A couple hundred calories.
Yeah.
If you're having a bulletproof coffee, you're having, we got Amazon here.
Ooh.
If you're having a bulletproof coffee in the morning, you're having a couple hundred calories, 200 calories, 300 calories, 400 calories. That is a meal. So if you're trying for autophagy or trying to go as long as possible and let your body eat away the fat on your body, then you need to try to cut out the bulletproof coffee. What I would say is if you're like me and you need something in your coffee, like you have to have a coffee in the morning and you need something, try to limit it to like 30 to 50 calories of either use the Kai-2 Super Creamer.
Right.
Or use a half a tablespoon of butter. Don't use heavy cream. There's carbs in it. You want a little bit, just enough to give you that creaminess, but you really want to try to not even do that.
Okay, can I completely fess up here?
Okay.
Full disclosure.
Okay.
This kind of speaks to, and why I've struggled with this a lot, the coffee. There's a part of me as a long-term dieter that associates deprivation as part of me getting healthy. Like, I'm supposed to feel deprived. I'm supposed to be ticked off about my life and my circumstances. And I think that sometimes I say to myself, what I'm drinking just doesn't count. I'm not counting it, whether it counts or not. I'm not counting it. So I think that that is why I was saying to myself, I'm not eating breakfast. I'm not even eating anything until 2 o'clock. I'm totally deprived. However, I had eaten 300 or 400 calories. Really, I just drank the 300 or 400 calories.
Right.
Actually, drinking keto chow and having that as a meal helped me kind of deal with what I was doing with coffee because, yeah, we were doing keto chow meals all the time because I was eating, you know, breakfast and lunch technically, right? Although I was saying I was OMADing because I'm like, well, everything I did before I ate solid food didn't count.
Right.
And I think that that was something I needed to kind of work through.
And I had a different struggle. My struggle was if I was in the car, I'd grab something, and it could be a little something. It could be three or four almonds that are in the center console, or a half a meat stick, or Anthony's got some kind of food. I'm gonna take one bite, I wanna try it. And I would sit there and go, I'm OMADing, I'm not eating a lot, I'm only eating one meal a day. But what I was doing was throughout the day, I was having 10 calories here, 20 calories here.
You were like disconnecting from it.
Right. And so now all of those little, a nut here, a nut there, it didn't equate to a lot of calories. It would maybe equate to 200, maybe 300 calories.
Yeah.
And when you consider I'm trying to eat 2000 calories, and this really started for me, I mean, it's always been an issue, but I had it under control, but it started for me on the reverse diet because all of a sudden I was eating 500 calories more than I was used to. And so I was like, how do I get them in? So I'm like, well, the best way for me to get them in is eat a breakfast or a midday meal kind of thing.
Right.
And then I'm like, okay, well, I'd much rather just have like 10 calories here, 20 calories here, 50 calories here. I'm going to have a bite of my keto brick instead of a half a brick as part of my meal, that kind of thing. So the problem was, even when it was only 200 to 300 calories throughout the day, it was 5, 10, 15 times that I was doing that, like each one being 20 to 50 calories. Here's the problem. As we said, every time I put something in my mouth, I'm spiking insulin.
Right.
So if I'm spiking my insulin, even with it being 2 or 3 nuts, 15 times a day, when is my body ever actually getting an opportunity to burn fat? Because what insulin is going to do, it's a fat storing hormone. It's going to start storing the fat.
Yeah.
So I never get to burn the fat because all day long I'm spiking my insulin.
Something that really resonated with me that you said though was I would take a bite of Anthony's food. And boy, that is something that really hits home for me because even as I was gaining a tremendous amount of weight as a young mother, you know, with kids, Caleb's food, toddler food, that's his meal. That I'm just eating a bite, a pot of his macaroni and cheese, but that's not my macaroni and cheese.
Right.
That's not my meal. I will have a bite of his and then I will have my meal, but like I'm separated from that. And so when you said that, like, well, it was a bite of Anthony's food. So I don't, you know, it's like, you're almost like, I'm not counting that as part
right.
of my meal. That's like, that's free. It's like, if you've ever done Weight Watchers and there were certain foods that were like, well, free, those are 0 points. Right. And you would like load up, I would make a soup of just all of those things. And it's like, well, I ate nothing today, really, technically.
Right.
And it's like, no, technically you absolutely ate something, but because there was a 0 point value assessed to it, you were able to do what you want to do as a food addict and just separate yourself from that behavior.
Right. So last one, Gail wrote,
hey Gail,
I really wish I had a doctor who is keto friendly. After that news last week about my familiar cholesterolemia, it has left me feeling really bewildered and scared and I don't know where to turn. I love the keto life and I want to be assured that I'm not headed towards disaster. Mm. I too have fibromyalgia, depression, anxiety, and insomnia, all of which I've struggled with since my youth. I will be 62 on February 13th, and I was doing pretty good until about 2 months ago with my anxiety, and it really helped to push through. But unfortunately, I had to go back on antidepressants, and I'm having a major episode now, having been off of the meds for 9 months. My doctor has now ordered me an at-home sleep study for the sleep apnea, and I had some ringing in my ears recently, which is preventing me from sleep. Even with all that said, I am committed to the keto lifestyle for 3+ years now. Please keep me in your prayers. I don't know how to handle all of this right now.
Well, Gail, I don't want you to get upset or to be worried. We are going to continue praying for you. And, you know, you are doing the best that you can. Do not be upset with yourself because you're having to get back on that medication. We're gonna pray that that medication does exactly what it needs to do and no more than that,
yeah.
You know? And the sleep study, I think, will be awesome. In the meantime, you have a whole family in this keto family that we are rooting for you, we are celebrating you, and we are not leaving tomorrow. We are here for the long haul and a year from now, 5 years from now, 10 years from now, we're going to be celebrating every single one of your milestones and successes. And I don't think that we can end this Keto on the Couch unless we sing her happy birthday.
Okay.
Because it's this week.
That's right.
February 13th.
Are you ready?
All right, here we go. Okay. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear Gail. Happy birthday to you. Gail, this is your year. We love you. And 62 is going to be an awesome year.
Well, that is a great place to end this week's Keto on the Couch.
Now, our 72-hour fast starts next week.
Yes. So next Sunday, we almost forgot about that. Thank you. Next Sunday, we're going to start our 72-hour fast. We're going to start it at 7 o'clock on Sunday with a live stream.
We're going to live stream there.
And we're going to kick it off there. And we're going to talk about it more on this week's live stream on Thursday at 9:30. Now, I did want to mention that we are going away for a couple of days.
Yeah.
So all plans are that we are going to get back in time to do the live stream on Thursday at 9:30. Eastern Standard Time, 9:30. If something comes up, we will put a notification in the community tab on YouTube as well as on our Facebook family group that, hey, we got stuck in traffic or something like that. We're not going to be able to live stream. And if we have to, we'll do it from our car.
Sometimes in
like
South
that.
Florida, it's a thing.
Yeah, you just don't know.
Traffic.
So, but that is the plan. But yes, so just start watching the community page. We're going to start talking about the fast, water fast, right? 72 hours. If you can't do water, if you need to do something else, don't worry about it.
Get your electrolytes.
Make sure you got your electrolytes.
Not
make
just
sure you
water.
Got salt, Redmond Real Salt.
Yep.
And if you want some Keto Chow fasting drops. So.
Love it.
So that is where we're going to end this week's Keto on the Couch. Please do us a favor and hit that like button down below.
Don't forget to subscribe to our channel and hit the little bell icon. That way, every single time we upload a new video, you'll be alerted to it.
Until next week.
Bye.